arriving and a really warm welcome to this church on this sunny day. It's lovely to see you here. Let's just take a moment before we begin. In the beginning, when it was very dark, God said, "Let there be light." In the beginning, when it was very quiet, the Word was with God. When the time was right, God sent the Son. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad.
Loving God, we have come to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Gospel calls us to turn away from sin and be faithful to Christ. As we offer ourselves to him in love, we renew our confidence and trust in his mercy. We say together, we come to you, Lord, for you alone can heal and restore us. We are not able to heal ourselves. We are not able to forgive ourselves. We are not able to restore ourselves. We are not able to sanctify ourselves. We come to you, Lord, for you alone can make us whole. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and with our mouth we will praise our Lord. We might not be able to sing in church at the moment, but we can still use the words of the ancient songs, the Psalms. So I invite you now, if you're able, to stand, and we'll go through this psalm together, Psalm 42. As the deer longs for the water brooks, so my soul longs for you, O God. My soul is thirsty for God, even for the living God. When shall I come for the presence of God? My tears have been my bread day and night, while all day long they say to me, "Where is now your God?" Now when I think on these things, I pour out my soul, how I went with the multitude and led the procession to the house of God. With a voice of praise and thanksgiving among those who kept holy day. Why are you so full of heaviness, O my soul? And why are you so disquieted within me? O put your trust in God, for I will yet give him thanks, who is the help of my countenance and and my God. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. At this point in the service, we're going to give thanks for everything that has been given to help the work of the Church. During the online services, during the time the Church has been closed, some people have been giving through our online system, and we want to give thanks for that too. It's good to be able to use technology in creative ways. All that has been given here on this plate, online or through monthly plans, we give thanks to God. Lord Jesus Christ, you emptied yourself, taking the form of a servant. Through your love, make us servants of one another. Lord Jesus Christ, for our sake you became poor. May our lives and gifts enrich the life of your world.
Chapter 14, verses 19 to the end. The angel of the God who was going before the Israelite army moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel, and so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a stronger east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on the right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of the Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt."
New Testament reading comes from Matthew, chapter 18, beginning at verse 21. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children, and all his possessions, and payment made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.' And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii and seized him by the throat. He said, pay what you owe. Then this fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported it to their lord, all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger his lord handed him over to be tortured until he could pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Queuing is something we do well in this country, isn't it? And queuing, I've noticed, has changed quite a lot in these past few months. And we've all seen those queues, haven't we? Outside the shops and the chemists, where people wait spaced out 2 metres apart in a long line. And I've also heard about the queues on the roads that lead to the drive-ins, as they queue to get their first McDonald's or their first KFC in months. They've blocked up the traffic and caused chaos. So imagine a queue where each person, spaced 1 metre apart, and everyone in Troon, everyone in Praise is in that queue, 8,600 people. This queue would be 5 miles long. That's sort of from here to Red Roof. And each person would be holding a sack full of coins, weighing, I don't know, about 30 kilos or 60 pounds, which the internet tells me is about carrying 4 Christmas turkeys. That's what you would need to carry the debt of the 10,000 talents that Jesus is talking about. That's a lot of coins. The smaller debt mentioned by the other slave, the 100 denarii, would fit in your pocket. What a difference between the two amounts. And why has Jesus told this parable? Well, of course, it came out of the question that Peter asked Jesus. How often must you forgive someone? Jesus gives the analogy of the cancellation of debt to help us understand more about mercy, compassion, and forgiveness. And he compares that burden of debt, that 5-mile queue burden of debt, owed by the king's slave, with the debt owed to the slave. If Peter had asked any other rabbi that day, he would have heard the traditional answer about forgiveness. It was widely accepted that you would forgive someone 3 times. The scriptures had been examined, the answer was found somewhere in one of the minor prophets. You can forgive a person 3 times, and then at the 4th offence, it was believed that God would administer punishment. How different was Jesus' answer to the popular teaching? Peter thought he was being quite generous when he suggested forgiving someone 7 times. But then Jesus replies with 77 times, or sometimes 70 times 7. And the implication is that forgiveness has no limit. Jesus tells this story to illustrate God's boundless forgiveness. Human beings are very good at imitating the first actions of the king in the story. We're very good at calling to account and judging other people. We're not so good at the second half. Humanity is less well known for compassion and cancelling large debts. And we see this playing out in the parable. The slave who has been let off a lifetime of debt does not learn from how he's been treated and misuses his freedom. And And then when the slave sees the man who owes him a pocket full of change, instead of treating him how he's been treated by the king, he tries to throttle him. This parable is a way of encouraging us to forgive as we have been forgiven, to have mercy on others as God's mercy has been on us, and to have compassion on those who wrong us because God has had compassion on us. Which is what we pray for, isn't it? Whenever we say the Lord's Prayer, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. God's forgiveness is not dependent on us forgiving others. And I believe this parable helps us understand that. Rather, God's forgiveness of us motivates and strengthens us to forgive those who do wrong to us. And I expect we can all remember times when we've been hurt by small things in our lives. And perhaps we do find it possible to forgive. But what about the big things? The unspeakable things that happen which hurt us or someone we love? Or when lasting damage is done to our physical and mental well-being, what then? Or the awful things that we see on the news when whole communities are wronged by violence or racism or man-made disaster, how can we forgive them? In fact, what exactly is forgiveness? Or perhaps we could begin with what forgiveness is not. Forgiveness is not forgetting that the hurt happened or pretending it didn't happen. Forgiveness is not a feeling. And it's not something that only begins when the other person says sorry or tries to make up for what they've done. And the expressions we have, such as forgive and forget, or wipe the slate clean, can be a bit misleading, as though the one in the wrong is not held to account, or that their behaviour is somehow condoned. Forgiveness is firstly a choice.
It's easy when we've been hurt to cultivate feelings of revenge and bitterness against the ones who have hurt us. But unfortunately, when our pain can build up in our hearts, it affects us more than the one who's done us wrong. But choosing to forgive sets us free. It frees us from the pain and can help the healing process. When we think of criminals who have intentionally set out to hurt people, they expect to be hated. When they are confronted with forgiveness, they are much more likely to reassess their lives. Forgiveness and mercy are powerful forces for change. But forgiveness takes time. Forgiveness is a process. It can sometimes take years. And actually, that's okay, because we're only human. What counts is our intention. Sometimes it begins with asking for God's help. God, I've been so hurt and they don't deserve my forgiveness, but help me to forgive even though I don't feel like it. The God we trust and believe in is so awesome and perfect and pure, and we owe our very lives to him. No one is worthy of standing before him. But the good news is that when God calls us to account, the judgment and the payment of debt falls on Jesus. And the mercy and compassion fall on us. We are freed from that burden. Remember that 5-mile queue of debt? In gratitude for that freedom and for what Jesus has done for us, we are called to do the same, to imitate God's mercy and forgiveness in how we treat others. And God, by his grace, will help us to do that. This parable shows how much God is willing to forgive us, and how the practice of forgiveness is a characteristic of the kingdom of heaven. When forgiveness happens, we glimpse a bit of heaven on earth. We see God's kingdom come and lives transformed. Amen.
I invite you now to stand if you're able to declare together our faith in God.
we believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please be seated as we have a time of prayer.
Let us pray to God, who alone makes us dwell in safety. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith. Strengthen Philip and Hugh, our bishops, and all your church in the service of Christ, that those who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. We bring before you our churches here in Treslothan and Crowan, Camborne, Tuckymill and Penpons. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless and guide Elizabeth our Queen, give wisdom to all in authority. Guide this and every nation in the ways of justice and of peace, that we may honour one another and seek the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who are affected by the coronavirus pandemic, through illness or isolation or anxiety, in this country and across the world. For nurses, doctors and medical researchers, that through their skill and insights, many will be restored to health. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give grace to us, our families and friends, and to all our neighbours, that we may serve Christ in one another and love as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the vulnerable and the fearful, for the gravely ill and the dying, that they may know your comfort and peace. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. In a moment of silence, we name before God those known to us. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all your saints, we commend ourselves and the whole creation to your unfailing love. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Collect, the Church's Prayer for Today. Almighty God, whose only Son has opened for us a new and living way into your presence, give us pure hearts and steadfast wills to worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Gathering our prayers and praises into one, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let me leave you with God's blessing. In fact, let's say this together to each other. The love of the Lord Jesus draws us to himself. The power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. The joy of the Lord Jesus fill our hearts. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. Lord, by your cross, we are redeemed.
Send us out to live for you.
Lord, your word is our rule and guide.
Send us out to follow you.
Lord, you are the light of the world. Send us out to shine for you. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.